Okay. Sorry, sorry, sorry. I forgot to record it. Well, anyway, I hope the note is pretty clear for now. We did number 22 earlier, and we get this answer. Okay, now number 24 here, we will apply the idea of center of mass into two dimension. Okay, now how will we do this? Now X bar will be the sum of the masses times the position in X over the sum of the masses. While the Y bar, as you expect, that's basically the same idea, the sum of the masses times yi over the sum of the masses. That's what we will do. Okay, now I guess I can ask you to do the simplest work. What is the sum of the masses? Sum of the masses is 18, is it right? Okay, now then, let me ask you to compute the sum of the masses multiplied by xi. So basically, the sum of the moments with respect to the y-axis, because that's basically the distance from the y-axis. This xi here, tells us the distance from the y-axis, the distance from the y-axis, this distance from y-axis is zero, and that would be the distance from the y-axis. Okay, now let me ask you to compute that. So for example, the moment of the first mass from the origin, which is the y-axis, is the mass times negative 4, okay, plus the mass times 0, because the x for mass 2 is 0, plus the mass times the distance from x equals 0, plus 6 times 1. Negative 20 plus 0 plus 9 plus 6, that's equals to 5. I'm sorry, negative 5. Therefore, my x bar now can be computed. That's negative 5 over 18. Negative 5 over 18 give me negative 0.27778. Approximately, here, let me use a blue color. Ah. Approximately. So if I hold all these masses here along this line, then it will be balanced and it will not fall to the left nor to the right. Okay, so if you hold it here, holding it at the point, now you hold that using a line. Okay, you use that. Using a line, hold it using x bar equals to negative 0.27778. Now, let me ask you to try to find the moment with respect to the moment with respect to the x-axis, basically the moment, the mass times the distance from the y-axis. Get the total. Okay, I'll give you 1 minute. And once you get that, I want you to find the y bar. So this will be 5 times 2 plus 4 times 5 plus 3 times 2 plus 6 times negative 2. That will be 10 plus 20 plus 6 minus 12. Oh, what's that? 24? Is that right? 36 minus 4, yeah, that's 24. So the y bar will be 24 over 18. Reduced by 6, that will be 4 over 3, huh? So that's 1.33333. Which means if I hold it using a horizontal line, I need to hold it around here. See, so it will be approximately this line. Okay, you hold it here, and y bar equals to 1.33333. Okay, now then the center of mass of these four masses is actually the coordinate x bar, y bar. Okay, so if I hold it using a horizontal line, then this is the horizontal line I need to use here. This is the location. This is location of the horizontal line, such that those masses does not tumble to the top or tumble to the bottom. Now, while if I need to hold it, if I use a vertical line to hold it, then I need to hold it here at this vertical line, x equals to -0.27778, such that the system doesn't tumble to the right nor tumble to the left. Now, let me use this illustration for you. Go back to that paper. Can you see me? Can you see me here? I will use this as my line. Okay, I will use this as my line. You see this? The edge will be a line, right? Now, we know that there's a point of center of mass for this paper earlier, right? But the idea is, because this is two dimension right now, how do I get the point? Now, to get the point, the center of mass, I first get the center of mass of the vertical line. Now this is the line. This is the line. I wonder if you can see it. Let me hold it up higher. This is the line that if I hold it, it doesn't tumble to the left nor to the right. You see that? Okay. Now, however, if I want to hold it this way, then I need to, this is the line that I need to hold it such that it doesn't tumble to the left nor to the right. Okay. Now, the intersection of this point, this intersection of these two lines here, will give me the center of mass, the point that I pointed earlier. The intersection of those two lines give me this point that I have earlier. Does it make sense now?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so this center of mass in two dimension is basically the intersection of two lines. Now, later on when you go to calc 3, we will do the same thing again, but at that time we will apply that to three dimension. Okay, but you will do one or two problems, now, number 21 and number 23, number 21 and number 23 later on as your suggested homework. Can you mute that, whoever that is? Thank you. Now then, what happened if instead of getting only those masses, we have something called lamina? Now, what is lamina to start with? Lamina is a continuous surface, okay, whose density is uniform. It means the weight at any point on any point of this region is equal to other points in this region. No point in this region is heavier or more dense compared to other points. Now, when I try to find the density, I mean the center of mass of this body, this lamina, then I need to develop the following idea. So let's say this is my lamina. Again, the word lamina implies that the density at any point of the on this body is the same, it's constant. The density is constant. Okay, I think our textbook using rho, rho of course is also constant. Rho refers to mass density, while delta refers to weight density. And the weight density is basically equal to rho times g, as we have seen on Monday. Now, the thing is then, how do we find the center of mass if we have, instead of only finite number of masses, we want to find the center of mass of a continuous surface lamina like this. Now, I will start with a nice situation. I will start with a square. Or not a square, a rectangle. Now, the center of mass of a rectangle is right at the center. So earlier, you saw that I was holding a rectangular paper. Is it right? Now, mm-hmm. how did I get the center of mass quite fast? Well, because I know the center of mass must be right in the middle. Okay, basically the way I look at that is I get the horizontal line cutting it into half this way, and vertical line cut it into half this way. Now the intersection of these two lines give me the center of mass. And you can try it yourself. You get the paper next to you, as long as it is rectangular. Okay, and try to place your finger, the point of your finger, right at the center of that rectangular paper. You will see it will be balanced. Okay, now that's where we start. Now, then, how do we use this fact to find the center of mass of a certain lamina? Suppose I have this lamina. Okay, and then let's say this is the lamina we will be dealing with. This is the lamina we will be dealing with. I don't want to shade them anymore. It takes me too much time. Now, then how do I find the formula to get the center of mass? Now, the way we will do it is as the following. I will dissect this, I will put this curve here, this region here into sections. I partition. Okay, a lot of partition. Now, let me get, for example, in particular, this one partition here, which I approximate using a rectangle. Okay, I will be dealing with this one rectangle here. Mm-hmm. Now, suppose, where's the center of mass for this rectangle? And the center of mass for this rectangle must be here, which is the midpoint. Which is the midpoint of the axis. Let's say this is x1, this is x2, and it must be x1 plus x2 over 2. Okay, and the y will be half of the height. Right? The y will be 1/2 of the f at x bar. Is it okay?
Mm-hmm.
Now, suppose I am interested in finding the moment with respect to the y-axis. Now, we know from the past that's the sum of m1 times x1. The moment from the x from the y-axis means the mass multiplied by the distance from the y-axis. Okay, let me not using x1, x2 there. Let me change this. Let's say this is xa and this is xb. Okay, so I will do the sum of the moments from the y-axis. Now, but at the same time, the mass of this one rectangle here, the mass of that one rectangle here is the same to the density times the area, okay, which is the y times dx, where my dx is the difference between xb minus xa. Okay, now, but this is the discrete version. I mean, if we have a finite number of masses, suppose we have the continuous version like what we have earlier, then this summation notation becomes integral.
Okay.
Rho y dx. Now the rho is constant, so we can pull it out. I think I miss. Oh, I'm missing something. My bad. My bad. My mass is. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I'm missing something earlier. I'm missing my x here. This is my mass. This is my mass. This is my mass. Right? I'm missing xi. I'm missing xi times xi. No wonder I feel like I'm missing something. Let me put my xi here. So I have my x here. I have my x here. Okay. Now fix it, please. I'm missing something earlier. No wonder I feel like something not right with this one. This is rho xy. Okay. I pull the rho out. So the moment with respect to the y-axis, which is x equals to 0, is rho times integral of x fx dx. Okay, if this guy is capital A, this is capital B, then that will be our limit of integration a to b. Okay, now how about the total mass? The total mass will be integral from A to B of rho y dx. Which is equal to, I can pull the rho out, integral from A to B of fx dx. Now you can imagine the mass is equal to rho times y times dx, right? Okay, so if I add all the masses, then I get that situation, the thing that I have here. Okay, if I add all the small masses, that's what I get. So at this point, suppose I want to find what is x bar, the center of the x component of center of mass, then x bar equals to the moment with respect to the y-axis over the mass. Okay, now where the moment with respect to the y-axis is given by that, the moment with the mass is this. Now, I want you to be aware of one thing though. Compare the formula for the mass. This is the formula for mass. And the formula for moment with respect to the y-axis. Do you see any similarity? Maybe I should ask the other way around. What's the difference?
That's the answer.
That's right. That's right. So to find the moment with respect to the y-axis, we actually insert x from the integral for the mass. Okay. That's the easy way to memorize that. That's the easier way to memorize that. Okay? Now, the thing is, this is two-dimensional, so I still need to find my y prime. How to find my y prime? Let me lasso this first. Okay, and then copy, I bring it down. Let's put it here. Now we want to develop how to find y prime. But to find y prime, I need to first find the moment with respect to the x-axis. The moment with respect to the x-axis in discrete form will be the mass times the distance from the x-axis. Right? That's the discrete form. That's the mass is what again? Rho times y times dx, right? But the thing is, for this bar here, for this strip here, the center of mass is located in the middle of the fx, right? Let's say this is the fx, it's only half of that. So this yi here, the center of mass there, it will be 1/2 of y. Then this becomes the sum of rho y squared over 2 dx. Now, that's the discrete version. Now, usually when we develop the integral, which is basically what I teach you here, we need to try to take a look at that situation from the discrete form first. Now, then once you are done with the discrete form, then this summation notation becomes. Comes integral, right? Instead, that's integral from A to B in this equation. I will pull the rho out. In fact, I pull the 1/2 also out. Pull the 1/2 out, I pull the rho out, integral from A to B. What happened to the y square? We replace that by fx being squared dx. Okay, now then later on our y prime will be the moment with respect to the x-axis over the mass that we have computed earlier. Okay, now that's the setup. You see that I basically take approximately 45 minutes just for the, no, I'm sorry. I take like around half an hour just to set it up. So the setup is not easy though, but I hope by going over this slow enough, then you learn how to set up integration for other type of situation in future. Okay, now then let's put some examples into this. Maybe I create a box first for you to memorize. You have to memorize this, that the moment with respect to the y-axis is rho integral from A to B of x fx dx, moment with respect to the x-axis is 1/2 rho integral from A to B, the square of fx dx, while the mass is integral times integral from A to B of fx dx. And x bar equals to moment with respect to the y-axis over the mass, y bar equals to the moment with respect to the x-axis over the mass, and center of mass is a coordinate. Should be presented as x bar comma y bar. Okay, you should memorize that. Let's do a problem. Suppose I take questions from number 26. Let me do it up here, number 26. I hope I don't take that much space. Number 26, sketch the region bounded by the curves and visually estimate the location of the centroid, and then find the exact coordinates for the centroid. And suppose I have this, and then number 26, y equals to square root of x. So y equals to square root of x. I think square root of x looks like this. Okay. Bounded by y equals 0 and x equals to 4. Y equals 0 is, y equals 0 is x-axis, right? And then x equals to 4. So we are dealing with, this region here. Now the center of mass, I think, is approximately somewhere here. I'm just guessing, okay? I'm just guessing. You will see that the center of mass should be kind of like in the middle of the region, supposedly, okay? Supposedly, like, even, it's not always true. There's a, there's a rules about what kind of region we are talking about, but there's something called convex regions, concave region. But if you have this kind of situation here, then the center of mass should be somewhere in between. Okay, now, how do we find this point here accurately? This is y equals to square root of x. Let's find the mass first. Do we know the rho?
What was the question?
Do we know the rho? If not, then that's fine. We just leave it as rho. So the mass equals to rho times integral from 0 to 4 of fx dx. Okay, so this is equals to rho times, that's 2/3 x to the power of 3/2 from 0 to 4. That is rho times 2/3. I think that will be 8 minus 0. So that will be 16/3 rho. Then, how about the moment with respect to the y-axis? According to the formula we have there, that's rho integral from 0 to 4 x times square root of x dx. It's rho times integral from 0 to 4 of x to the 3/2 dx. It's rho times 2/5 x to the 5/2 from 0 to 4. It's rho times 2/3 times what is 4 to the power of 5/2. Repeat again. Yeah, 4, let me write it here. 4 to the power of 5/2, that's square root of 4, whatever the result, take it to the power of 5. 2/5 is 32, right? Minus 0. And we will get 64/5 rho. therefore, then the x bar, we can compute x bar right now. X bar will be 64 over 5 rho divided by 16 over 3 rho. The rho cancels. So I get 64 over 5 times the reciprocal 3 over 16. That's 12 over 5, that's 2.4. Which means if I go back to my graph up here, then the position of this line is approximately at 2.4. X equals to 2.4. If I hold this lamina here using X equals to 2.4 line, then it will be balanced. It won't tumble to the right, it won't tumble to the left. Okay, now next, I want you to compute what is the moment with respect to the x-axis. What is the moment with respect to the x-axis? According to the formula, that's 1/2 rho integral from 0 to 4 fx squared, or square root of x being squared dx. Duh, this is way too easy. Is 1/2 rho times 1/2 x squared from 0 to 4. Fast forward, this is 4 rho, such that the y bar will be 4 rho over 16 over rho. That's 4 times 3 over 16, that's 0.75. So the center of mass will be, center of mass will be 2.4. 2.4 comma 0.75. If we look back to the graph here, then this point supposed to be, this is 2.1, slightly less. Supposed to be around here. This is the y bar equals to 0.75. That's the coordinate supposed to be. If you try to do it a bit more accurate, right? Okay, now the procedure to find the x bar and y bar is given here. Now, I'm about to give you a break together with one problem. Let me ask you to do number 28. Number 28, we have the graph y equals to sine x, y equals to 0, and the x will be from 0 to pi. Okay, now find the mass first, and then the moment with respect to the y-axis, the moment with respect to the x-axis, then you find the x-bar and y-bar. Okay, right now it's 5:32, I think it should take you like what, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, like approximately 18 minutes from now.
Okay.
I mean, 8 minutes plus 10 minutes break, we come back at 5:50.
Okay, Professor, really quick, can you scroll back up? Because I got a different Y value. I'm trying to see where I went wrong. Okay, so you did that, and that equals X 1/2 over P times, and it's 3/4. Okay, it was arithmetic. I got it. Thank you.
We will come back at 5:55.
Okay.
Supposed to be 5:50, but let me make it 5:55. So we come back at 5:55. Okay, let's start again. Let's do it here for part A. The mass will be rho times integral from 0 to pi of fx, so sine x, dx. I believe the answer is 2. Is it right? That's negative cosine x from pi. 0, that's rho times negative of negative 1 minus times plus 1. So that's a 2 rho. For you guys, it may be useful if you memorize this, that for the graph of sine and cosine, the area of that one quadrant, so 0 to pi over 2, pi over 2 to pi, the area here is 1, the area here is 1, the area here is negative 1, negative 1. Yeah, of course, we don't shrink or stretch that. Okay, if the regular sine graph or cosine graph, in this case, this is y equals to sine graph. And the, that's how I say that, oh, that's have to be true because I know the area for one quadrant is 1. So the area for another one quadrant is symmetric. There must be another 1. But anyway, that's to speed up your computation. Okay, second, how about the moment with respect to y axis, that's rho times integral from 0 to pi x sine x dx. How to do this? Integration by parts?
Yes, I did by parts.
Mm-hmm. So this is equal to rho times negative x cosine x plus sine x from 0 to pi. That will be rho times negative pi times cosine pi plus cosine pi is 0 minus, that's 0 plus 0, I believe, right? So I will get, this will be pi rho. Part C, moment with respect to x-axis, that's rho 1/2 rho times integral from 0 to pi of sine squared x dx. That's 1/2 rho times, I need to do half angle. That will be one minus cosine 2x over 2 dx. Fast forward, that will be 1/4 rho times pi. Okay, because I know cosine 2x, integral over cosine 2x is equals to 0 on interval 0 to pi. So a moment with respect to x will be mu rho over 4, pi over 4 rho. Now, you may wonder how, Thomas, you can do this integral so fast and you say that the integral will be 0. Here's the logic. That's why when you do your integration, think at the same time, okay? Now, basically we will integrate from 0 to pi of cosine 2x dx, right? Now, but this integral, if you interpret that, that's the total area of cosine 2x from 0 to pi. Now, don't forget, cosine 2x, the period is pi. Right? Now, while we also know that the area here and the area here supposed to be, the total should be the same with the total area here. You see what I mean? The area here, let's call that, it's supposed to be 1/2, the area is 1/2. This will be -1/2, this is -1/2, this is +1/2. So if you do the integral from 0 to pi, of course they kill each other. Right? That's why it becomes 0. Okay, now then that's for part C, part D. What is the center of mass? The center of mass x bar, y bar, therefore equals to the moment with respect to the y-axis over the mass, comma, moment with respect to the x-axis over mass. This will be, what did I get earlier? Pi rho. So that's pi rho over 2 pi. And let's say pi over 4 rho over 2. So cancel this, cancel that. Oh, I'm sorry. Where's my mass again? Not 2 pi, 2 rho, not 2 pi. Typo, should be rho here. I know my rho will cancel, that's why. So that will be pi over 2 comma pi over 8. Furthermore, what happens if the region is actually not bounded by y equals to 0? Suppose, let me start here so that you have time to copy that down. Suppose now we have the following situation that my curve is actually bounded above by fx and bounded below by gx. Want to get the center of mass of this region from A to B. Now then, the moment, the mass is easy, the mass will be basically the mass of the whole thing minus the mass. So when I say the mass of the whole thing, I refer to the whole thing here. The mass of the whole thing.
F of x.
Yeah, minus the mass of the one that you don't want. Okay, so So the yellow part basically, the yellow part, the leftover yellow part is basically the rho integral AD of fx dx minus rho integral AB gx dx, right? Which when we put together, you see that's rho times integral from A to B of fx minus gx dx. Okay, the moment with respect to the y-axis will work very similarly. That's rho times integral from A to B x of times fx dx minus rho times integral from A to B of x gx dx, which if I factor the rho outside and the x inside, you will get x times the difference. Okay, now I hope you notice that seems like we still have the same principle. You insert the x, so from the mass you insert the x. Now, how about the moment with respect to the x-axis? That will be rho times integral A to B of fx being squared dx minus rho times integral from A to B of gx squared, which if I factor the rho, keep the integral, then I will get fx being squared minus gx being squared in as the radicand, as the integrand.
So with this mx, we don't have a 1/2.
You're right. I forgot
that. Bound.
Yeah, I forgot the 1/2.
Oh, okay.
Sorry. Yeah, thank you. Otherwise, we'll get the wrong form. Yes, we have the 1/2.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. So, using that, let's do question number. Let me see which question you want. I want to do number, let's say number 32. So the region is bounded by y equals to x cubed, x plus y equals to 2, and y equals to 0. I wonder what it looks like. Y equals to x cubed should look like this. Approximately like this. X plus y equals to 2, that's a line. Its slope negative 1, so let's say approximately. And then y equals to 0. So we are talking about this region. But nothing fun with this though. There are two ways to do this. One way is, let's compute the mass first. How would you compute the mass here? If you compute the mass and you do the integral, the mass equals to, I'll give you some idea. The mass equals to integral from this guy to this guy, right? I think this is true. but they intersect at 1, I believe, 1, 1. Now, the thing is, then you will have integral from 0 to 1, that's bounded by x cubed, plus integral from 1 to 2, bounded by 2 minus x. You see what I mean? So maybe I delete this. So let's say this is the first part. That's the mass for the first part. And this is the mass for the second part. Well, that's one way to do. That's one way to do. Can you follow me, everybody? Because I'm about to offer you something else. Yeah, I'm about to offer you something else. Another way to look at that is, instead of breaking into two parts, instead of breaking it into two parts, I may consider integrating it with respect to dy. So let's see if I can do it this way. Mass equals to integral from 0 to 1. My y will be from y equals to 0 to y equals to 1. And then for any y, the upper function is 2 minus y, minus the lower function is, cube root of y. Okay. Now you can compare, you do these two integrals here, the result should be the same. The result should be the same. Imagine if I reflect this though. Imagine if I reflect this graph. This is x-axis here, this is y-axis. Imagine if I reflect that. This is my y-axis here. This is my x-axis. X plus y equals to 2. Oops. X plus y equals to 2 is still a diagonal line. Okay. But then my cube root of y looks like this. And the region we need is actually this region. The region we need is actually this region. The line is x equals to 2 minus y, and this guy here is y, x equals to y to the power of 1/3. Okay, the intersection, like earlier, that's 1, 1. So the integral I did here has something to do with this shape here. Okay, compared to the first one, the one I did here has something to do with this graph. The one that I say, there are two points of view, two ways to integrate. So you integrate with respect to the x-axis, the first one, which means you need to divide the region into two parts, or you integrate with respect to the y, you have only one region. Now, the reason I show you the second method here, is because that's the way we will do, apply what we did earlier. So the moment with respect to the y-axis will be equals to 1/2 rho integral from 0 to 1 of the upper function, that's 2 minus y squared, minus the lower function, y to the 2x. While moment with respect to the x-axis, that's equal to rho times integral from 0 to 1 of y times upper function minus lower function. Since you have learned technique of integration, I will just leave it there. Okay. Again, don't trust me too much. Don't trust me too much in the sense that I show you an alternative method to do problems here. This is my alternative method. Okay. If you want to, you try to do that first, and then you try to do it using this way. Okay, now the result should be the same though. Okay, the result should be the same. There's a lot of graphs there, huh? Okay, that's where I'm gonna stop for my 8.3, I will go on to, instead of going to 8.4 and on, I will jump to chapter 10. 10.1, which is, why my graph is different. Okay, so what happened? Okay, 10.1 is curve by parametric equations. We will be dealing with curve that is defined by t, or sometimes we call that time. And the curve may not be a function, like the y may not be a function of x, but still a function of time. So the way we will do it will be pretty much that this coordinate xy here will each one of them a function of time. Okay, so you can see that in the past, we have y as a function of x. So once you know the x, you know the y. Right now, x and y both function of t. So if you tell me the t, I will get the x, I will get the y. Okay, now to have some good feeling on, a better feeling on what is parametric equation, let's take a look, for example, on if you have your textbook with you, or I will take the picture, we will take a look on example one in our book. Take a look, and I will try to take the picture of that. Second. This is example one from our textbook, where the parametric equation is defined by x equals t squared minus 2t and y equals to t plus 1. Now, the reason I copied that here, because I want to go over that a bit. The idea is that you see that I look at the function of t. When t equals to negative 2, what's the x and y? T equals to negative 1, what's the x and y? So on and so forth. So eventually, we get the coordinates 8, comma, negative 1, 3, comma, 0, 0, comma, 1, and so on and so forth. Oh, thank you. Is it the same graph, Austin?
It should be.
Yeah, that's what I have also. Just in case that I look at the wrong one, you know? Okay, so
it's the same.
Yeah. Now we have these coordinates. Then I plot them. So I plot them, for example, when t equals to negative 2 here, the coordinate is 8, negative 1. 8, negative 1, this is the coordinate, right? And then when t is negative 1, I get 3, 0. Now this is 3, 0. And 0, 1, so on and so forth. When t equals to 1, t equals to 2, t equals to 3, t equals to 4. Now once you get those points, then we connect them. So imagine if I don't have this curve here, I get only those points, then I will use my pen or my pencil, then try to connect these points here. Okay, now the nice thing about parametric equation, we have the sense of time. So at what time, where will this point located? Okay, parametric equation is very commonly used when we try to see the trajectory of, for example, a satellite, a missile, or when you throw something, at what point, where's the location of that thing? If you throw the stone, at what time will the stone be at what position? Okay, so the use of parametric equation is especially because we insert the idea of time and the position. At what time, what position we have. Now, that's one example, but I want to do my own example now. I hope my example is easy enough. I pick questions from our book. Let's say I do number 8. The parametric equation, x equals to t minus 1, y equals to t cubed plus 1, where my t will be only from negative 2 to positive 2. The question is sketch the graph. Okay, plot the coordinates. In a second, I need to turn off. To get a good feeling of this, let me construct the table. This is my t, this is my x, this is my y. I will do my t from negative 2 up to 2. Of course, if you want to refine your graph later on, then you fill more t's here, okay? And then let me give you 1 or 2 minutes to find the corresponding coordinates. Let's say when t equals to negative 2, x is negative 3. And then the y will be negative 8 plus 1 is negative 7. And so on and so forth. Let me ask you to fill it up first. When t equals to negative 1, the x is negative 2, the y is 0. When t is 0, the x is negative 1, the y is 1.
1.
When t is 1, the x is 0, the y is
2.
And when this is 1, this will be
9.
Mm-hmm. So next I will try to graph that. Say my coordinate system is here. Okay, and then my coordinate, when x equals to negative 2, my y is negative 3, comma, negative 7. 2, 4, 5, 6, 7, approximately here. That's when t equals to negative 2. When t equals to negative 1, that's negative 2 comma 0. When t is 0, that's negative 1 comma 1. When t equals to 1, that's 0 comma 2. And then when t equals to 2, that's 1 comma 9. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Oh, that's very far up here. Yeah, let's say it's here, just for sake of simplicity. So the curve seems to be like this. Okay, and oh, because the t only starts from negative 2, I should not have this extra. I should not have this extra. It should be from here. Stop there. Okay, this is when t equals to negative 1, t equals to 0, t equals to 1, and then I stop at t equals to 2. Okay, now. But this technique only help us with the sum points. We don't really get the good details of the graph. Now, if we want to get a better detail of the graph, we can say more about that, the direction. So when t equals to negative 2 is here, as t progresses, then the point, the graph actually go to this direction, going there, right? Maybe I use blue color. So it goes to that direction. That's the direction of the curve. Okay, now if we want to get a better graph, hold on. May I ask who did this?
Oh, sorry, Professor.
No, that's okay. Actually, I always wonder if you can actually write something on the board.
Yeah, so if you click on the top and go to view options.
Uh-huh.
When you drop that down, you'll see zoom ratio, request remote controller, annotate. If you click on annotate, an additional menu will pop up, and then you can use your mouse, put text on the field, and then...
Okay. So what happened here? I did not disable my participants annotation. Okay. Don't worry. I'm totally fine with that. It means that we can have a better discussion in future.
I'll delete that.
Oh, but I cannot delete it, huh? Do it again, please.
One sec. How did I draw?
Okay, so it means if you annotate that, I cannot delete it. Hmm. Oh, I see. Okay, that makes sense. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Okay, now, but at times, we want to have a better feeling about what the graph. So one technique to do so is to eliminate the parameter. Now, for this parametric equation here, we say the parameter is t. Parameter is t. What we will do is we will eliminate the t such that we see the relation, a direct relation between x and y. Okay, and how to do that? Let's say I pick x here. X equals to t minus 1, so t equals to x plus 1, is it right? And then I substitute that into the other equation. Y equals to x plus one cubed plus one. Okay, so the graph of this equation, the graph of this equation is basically the graph of x cubed. That's basically the graph of x cubed. But we move one unit to the left and one unit. Okay, one unit to the left and then one unit up. You see what I mean? Now, however, you need to be careful. We need to be a bit careful. The graph that we get here, the graph we get from eliminating the parameter from t eliminated. Is usually, as far as I see so far, is always the case, is usually larger than the original p parametric equation. Now I will give you some function, but in this case you see that the graph that we did here, the graph that we did here is actually the graph of x plus one being cubed plus one. Okay, where this is the quote unquote the vertex, right? That's the vertex. Okay, now. By doing the plotting the way we did that here earlier, we'll get the sense of the direction from where to where. Now, by doing the eliminating the parameter, we get the shape. So together with the shape and the direction, we get a better view of that parametric equation. Now, here's the thing. Imagine if I have this question. For example, I say that x equals to sine t, y equals to sine t. I try to emphasize what I say here. Okay, now. From this parametric equation, we can say right away that x equals to y. Is it right?
I guess I'm a bit lost on kind of a lot of this.
Oh, this is new. Don't worry. Okay, let me keep it here first. Let's go back to number 8. The first method I did is by tracing it, by plotting it. Like that's why I did this. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I got that one.
Uh-huh. Now then, to have a better feel of what the shape looked like, because when I did the plotting here, I just know where it starts, where it goes, and some points in between, but I can't really tell what's the shape supposed to look like. Okay, so then to get a better shape, feeling of the shape, I eliminate the parameter. That's how I get the equation relating x and y directly without t, without the parameter. From here we see, oh, that's actually a cube function. Move to the left 1 unit and move up 1 unit. Okay,
mm-hmm.
That's how we get the direction using tracing. To get the shape, I use eliminating the parameter. Now, what I want to explain right now is the one I circle with the yellow color here. What do you mean, Thomas, that the graph of the t eliminated, if we eliminate the parameter, usually that graph is larger than the original parametric equation. Let's see this example here. When x equals to sine t, y equals to sine t, then we can deduce right away that x equals to y. Now, the graph of x equals to y or y equals to x, the graph of x equals to y or y equals to x is actually this line. This is the line. This is y equals to x, right? Now that y equals to x line is actually going indefinitely far. Are you with me?
Yeah.
The problem is, if we look back to the function, if we look at the function, x equals to sine t, what is the range for x?
-1 to 1.
That's right. So the x will be between negative 1 to 1. Likewise, the y, if you look at that, whatever the t you plug in, the y will be from negative 1 to 1. Now, so what I meant by saying that once you get the equation that eliminate the parameter, this graph here is larger than the supposed graph. This graph there is larger than the parametric graph. Now, what is the parametric graph? The parametric graph is only a segment, actually. It's only a segment from -1, -1 to +1, +1. Only here. Only there. Okay, but one thing we know for sure that the graph of this parametric equation must be part of that equation where we eliminate the parameter. So the graph here, must be part of this graph. If they are not equal, then it must be part of that. Okay. It has something to do with the range and the domain, the range of the x and the y in the parametric functions. Let's do one more. Another example, let x equals to e to the t and y equals to 2e to the t minus 1. Now, if I just want to find the shape of the graph, then you will see that y equals to 2x minus 1. The graph for 2x minus 1 looks like approximately like this. That's y equals to 2x minus 1. But if you think about it, what is the range of x? The range for x will be
all real numbers?
Zero.
No.
Zero
from what?
To infinity.
Zero to infinity, right? Including zero or not? Not including zero. Is it right? Okay. So
yes.
We know that this parametric equation here, at most equal to this graph, okay? But at least it is part of this graph. Now, once we know the range is from zero to infinity, then we know, oh, okay, then the x will never be zero. But start from x equals to zero. So the graph actually start from here. Right? And it will progress in that direction. It will move in along that line. Okay? And the strange thing is, it actually moves faster and faster. It's not moving. It is moving on the line, but the speed is actually getting faster. Let's see. You see, when t equals to zero, the x is one, the y is what am I doing? 2x.
It's 1.
Oh yeah, 2x. So hold on. So I kind of like start from a wrong place here. No, it's not from there, huh? When t equals to 0, oh, my bad. That's 1,1. So 1,1 is here. And this is when t equals to 0. Right? Okay. Now, notice that when t equals to 1, and compare that with t equals to 2, compare that with t equals to 3, it actually going faster and faster in this path. In this path. However, when you go backward, you do t equals to negative 1, t equals to negative 2, it goes back to here very, very slow. Imagine that for me to move from this t equals to 0, 1,1, for me to move from that 1,1 to here, it takes how long?
One second.
Are you sure?
T equals 0.
This is when t equals to 0, right? Okay, this is when
and t then equals it equals.
Zero. Yeah, this is when t is what? Negative infinity. So for me to move from here, from here, go back to this point here, it takes me forever. Right? While for me to move the same distance, if I copy paste this line here and move from here to there with the same distance, it takes me like only 1 or 2 unit of time. But it takes me forever from here to here. Okay, I hope that explains why this becomes quite interesting.
I thought that that was supposed to be lower down on the graph.
Oh, yeah, that's right. I need to change that. Delete. Like this, approximate earlier, right?
Mm-hmm.
So there's a sense of time that even though the distance seems to be the same, but the time for me to move from here to here takes much, much longer time compared to the time I need to move from here to the same distance there. Okay, that's what makes this, again, this parametric equation becomes quite interesting because we insert the sense of time. What did I do? That's one example. Let's do more examples from the book. I like this one here. I think I want to describe to you in the next 5 minutes this one. Seem to be a special parametric function. X equals to cosine t, y equals to sine t. If we eliminate the parameter, you will see that x squared plus y squared equals to 1. So it's supposed to be a unit circle. supposed to be a unit circle. This is 1, this is 1, negative 1, negative 1. When we trace the time, when t equals to 0, the x is 1, the y is 0. So this is when t equals to 0. When the t is pi over 2, the x is 0, the y is 1. Okay, so we get the general shape from here. But by doing this tracing, we see the direction. Okay, it moves in this direction. When t equals to pi, the x is negative 1, the y is 0. This is when t equals to pi. It moves here. When t is 3 pi over 2, the x is 0, the y is negative 1. T is 2 pi, we go back to 1, 0. Okay, that's the graph. There are so many things that we can say from this parametric equation, parametric function. In fact, just let you know, in your when you go to calculus 3 later on, you will see parametric equation again in chapter 13. In fact, what you do in two sections in chapter calculus 2, 10.1 and 10.2, will be covered in a lot more details once you are in calculus 3. And that will be, I think, chapter 13.1 to 13.7. There are so many things we can say. One thing that I say kind of strange is the following though. Try to imagine with me, together with me, okay? Let's say this is Thomas House and this is West LA College. Okay, and then let's say this is Mike's house here. And I hope 1 or 2 years later, he goes to UCLA or even better. Okay, now notice that Thomas will still go to West LA College because I work there for the next 20 years. And Mike will go to UCLA, hopefully only for 2 years and graduate. Are you with me?
Yes.
Okay, now the thing is, do you notice that my path and Mike's path actually intersecting?
Yes.
Does it mean we have accident?
Does it mean what?
Does it mean we have accident?
Yes.
The answer is no. No. Our path may be intersecting, but as long as we are not at the same place at the same time, we are not colliding. You see? Okay?
Mm-hmm.
When I go from here to there on one specific day, maybe Mike also go to UCLA. Our path is intersecting, but it doesn't mean we have accident. Why? Because when I'm right here, Mike may be still here. You see? And yeah. while I get there to this point, then Mike get to that point. So you see, even though our path is intersecting, we don't have accident because we don't reach the same coordinate at the same time. Right? Now, imagine the following. I try to give you a little view on what will happen in car 3. Imagine Thomas, I throw a stone. Or if you want to think a bit more, Thomas shoot a missile. Okay? And to what you want to call, to maybe West Korea, if any. Okay. Nothing against Korean. Yeah, I just come up with something. Okay? and then a Korean there, a West Korean, want to intercept my missile. So West Korean come up with a faster missile to intercept that. Okay, now the thing is for West Korean missile to intercept my missile, we need to actually reach this point at the same time. Right? You see what I mean? When I shoot it, once I get here, then your missile is supposed to get there too. Okay, what you don't want to happen is by the time the interceptor reach here, once the interceptor reach here, my missile already here. So, I mean, I still get you, West Korea. You see what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so when we try to find, when we try to intercept Thomas' missile, first my path has to intersect his path. Second, I need to reach the same point when Thomas' missile reach that point. So not only the coordinate has to be the same, the time has to be the same too. You see? That's how we intercept a missile.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Now, I hope one day one of you or some of you get interested in weaponry. We still need that though, even though I heard some of you going to chemistry. Biochemistry is something very interesting right now. Talk about this COVID, right? Okay, and we like it or not, we have to admit, regardless if this COVID is purposely done or not, and everybody, every country has realized that's a very good bioweapon. You know, so either they need somebody to develop some virus or they need a lot more people to develop the vaccine. That's a job there. Okay, I'm not teaching you moral. I'm teaching you what we need in future. Okay? Well, anyway, at least for now, that's the idea of parametric equation. Now, let's go back to this circle. Oh, it's already 7 o'clock. I'm sorry. When we come back, hold on. Then I need to go say the following. Monday is April the 13th. Because it is falling on the 13th, we don't have class. I make up stories. No. Now, if you look at our syllabus, April the 13th is no class day. No class day. It's because of my union. Okay, it's supposed to be our spring break extension. Okay, but I will use this day here to answer questions. Yes, Austin? Oh, what's that?
I think it was a clap. I think it's a clapping.
Oh, I thought you kind of like smack my head. Well, anyway, yeah. So you don't need to attend the class because you are not formally required. But I think since I will stay at home anyway, I mean, this is the worst spring break, that you spring break at home. You think about where you want to go, your bedroom or your living room or your kitchen. well, anyway, so I will go online And but I would like you to let me know if you have questions and what time you're gonna ask me questions, so that I'm not sitting here doing nothing with my earphone, and not basically doing nothing. Okay, so please let me know if you have questions. And on Wednesday, you will have a test. Now, how will your test be done? Again, your test will be done this way. I will post your test. On Wednesday, I will post your test at 4 o'clock. At 4 o'clock. Okay? I assume you have printer. So you will print it out, and you start working on that at around 7 o'clock. Then you will scan it if you have scanner. After you scan it, upload it to Canvas under assignment test 2. Now, what happens if you don't have scanner? Then you take the picture. You take the picture, okay? If possible, when you take your picture using your smartphone, hopefully you can use this cam scanner at the same time and convert that to PDF. Okay, now the reason is if you don't use PDF, it takes much longer time to upload the JPEG or JPG file format to Canvas. It takes a lot longer. The student who said that to me, she said that, Thomas, I have 10 pictures. It took me more than 30 minutes to upload these 10 pictures. Okay, so change it to a PDF. And once it is PDF, you can just make it black and white. It doesn't have to be colored. Okay. What happened if you have Surface or iPad? Now, this is especially those people who write on computer. Now, if you have Surface or iPad and you feel comfortable writing directly to the pad, then go ahead. You can write directly to the pad without printing. So you don't need to print it out, you just do it there. And you save it as PDF and upload to Canvas. Okay, so this is the main procedure. This is the main procedure. If you don't have any one of the tool, then you modify that. What I know is 7:15, it's already uploading. Okay, I will set the system to start taking the submission at 7:15. Okay, that's where I will stop. See you all.